at an early age, one of the earliest memories that I had was my parents getting divorced. And that's like the first detailed image that I have ingrained in my mind. My mom raised me pretty much on her own. Always gone to church, like, but I call it a CEO. It was like Christmas and Easter only, you know? So I had accepted Jesus. I think I want to say I was around 8 or 9. Then my mom got remarried, and my stepdad, he was a person who just had wealth, but he wasn't somebody who trained up a child in the way they should go. So it was more of a animosity towards my real father, earthly father, who never poured into my life. I looked to my own earthly desires from high school on is when I started getting introduced to drinking and drugs and promiscuity.
I grew up with both my parents still married, 45 years, very loving. We did not go to church a lot. I know we did here and there, and they tried to make me sometimes, but I didn't grow up that way, so I didn't want to go every Sunday, not even close to every Sunday. But I grew up with family, always with family around, aunts, uncles, cousins, grandparents, both sides of my family, always grew up with love at all times. Got married when I was 19. Before we got married, I knew there was things I didn't like. I knew I probably shouldn't have gotten married so early. Even though I grew up in a very, very loving home, it was a little bit really strict on me. So I knew I wanted to get out on my own so I could not have anyone tell me what to do. So I chose getting married. And when I did, I had 2 girls. It was not easy getting a divorce. My parents are still married. But when I did, it was the best thing that happened to me. But it was like a weight, a huge amount of weight lifted off my shoulders, because I knew I was being cheated on. I knew there was a lot of things going on. But the pride took over. I didn't want to be the one. I was embarrassed. I didn't want to get divorced. I wanted things to work out, especially for your kids.
My early 20s, like I said, I was running with wild crowd. The group of guys I hung around with, we'd always go out, party, and struggle with alcoholism. And I ended up getting a DWI. And I was like, man, it might be time for me to settle down. And one night I was out at a bar and met my first wife, and my lifestyle didn't change, because she liked to do the same things that I did at the time, just go out and party. And when you do things like that, it's not healthy, one, for your physical body, but it's really extremely dangerous as far as your spiritual body, because when you it changes your mindset, the way you speak to each other, the things you do, so I would speak harshly, cuss words. I was had anger issues too, still towards my father. So I never physically, but verbally I would hurt her. And then physically, if any man came around, I wasn't scared to get in fights. It was like I just needed something to take my anger out on. And so needless to say, that relationship ended up in a divorce too, but it did give me a beautiful daughter out of it. So after my divorce, it's kind of crazy how we're two separate people in two separate worlds. And not literally, but...
And got divorced the same month.
Same month, we're divorced. Never knew each other, never been... But yet, we could be at the same place 9 months after our divorce and then see each other and make a connection. And in the beginning of our relationship, I'm not going to say it was perfect, because I still had some things I was dealing with as far as alcoholism and the way I would speak to people.
Within these 10 years that we've been together, he has had 5 or 6 incidents that he had cussing me. And it's only when he drank. There would be days when if he and I were together, it would be perfect. It would be one little thing that would set him off, maybe someone that looked at me. everyone knew something happened because everyone knew that he's yelling at the person, and then he would turn around and say it's my fault for the situation. And I'm sitting at a table eating with him, not even knowing who this person is, not even paying attention. There was times that he had a wandering eye. I could not have that. I've already been cheated on a lot. I want love. That was the first thing I wanted out of a marriage. Love, complete love. I had been cheated on. There was no room for that. And I didn't understand why he did, because we lived so good and everything seemed so perfect, like a family should be, with the kids, and we've done so many vacations. We just did so much together. When I would notice it, and it wasn't all the time, but I couldn't have it at all because it was so hurtful. We went to counseling, and when we would go to counseling, all the times he would tell me, oh, you want to cause an argument, or, you know, when I would see it, I would call him out on it. Now, when we went to counseling, he had admitted to everything. Out, he would cry in counseling. He would cry a lot in counseling. And I thought, all those times he yelled at me saying I was lying to him, I wasn't seeing it, but he admitted to all of it. He had done it again, and I just couldn't. I just had to make sure I could show my kids exactly who and the kind of person, man, that they need in their life.
So we were still in our transition where I'm still doing things I shouldn't, and we were attending another local church here, another local Baptist church, and we were trying to get plugged in there. We were, you know, going to Sunday school class, but it's just like we wanted to learn, but we weren't learning and weren't changing. I don't, maybe it was just too dry. I don't know, just not a spirit. So we just started saying, man, we got to start trying to find somewhere else to go. And then we did. We got a postcard in the mail about Free Life Church. Even there, man, the moment we went, it was like, wow. Just the praise, the worship music, the people, you know, loving people. And then, of course, the preaching was second to none. But you, like I said, you could just feel the presence.
It just grabbed us.
The Holy Spirit, you could just feel it in there. You feel the hand of God over the entire place. Mm-hmm. And it was one of those places that you wanted to go. It was like, man, I can't wait to go back, you know? And after that, I didn't change overnight, but he's been working on me ever since. And I wouldn't change it for anything. I wouldn't be anywhere else. A lot of people, and I did this too, go through things, and they'll go through a tragedy or something, be it alcoholism, physical abuse, verbal abuse. We've lost twins. So if you've lost children, there's a lot of things you can go through in life. Your father, cheating, anything, drugs, alcoholism. You pick which one fits you, because we've been through all of them. But you can point the finger. A lot of people will point the finger at God on certain situations, or even the D church. They'll go to church and be like, been there, done that. Those people aren't, you know. But you don't go there for. I don't go there for those people. Yeah, they're part of the body of Christ. But humans will still let you down. Humans in your life will let you down. Be it a Christian friend, be it even maybe a pastor, even one of your best friends from church. Humans, we're still flesh. So the moment that people have that revelation and the clarity that I don't go there because the preaching's good, but it is. I don't go there because the praise and worship's good, because it is. I go there because he's always good. So when you go there for him, take your focus off the other people. That's all part of the body of Christ. But we're still flesh, just like you. Just like you, I'm flesh. Pastor's flesh, just like me. So we may have our moments where we fall, but quit trying to say, well, that church let me down, or that He won't let you down. So when you have the revelation that God will never let you down, it's about Him. I'm there. Everybody on the church, everybody singing one day could all have laryngitis and be sick. But I'm still going to praise. I'm still going to worship because He's who He is. He's always, He'll never let you down. He's on the throne. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. So the moment I had that revelation and I was like, man, it's about Him. It's about who He is. He loves you. He loves you. He's never going to change. And then that's the day I was like, man, I'm sold out. I'll do whatever it takes to get more people to Christ, whatever it takes. And I know that if I didn't go through the things that I went through, I never would have met her. In essence, I never would be here. In essence, I never would have been at the church I met. And I never would, you know, have the experiences to be able to share and point people that go through the same trials and testimonies and help lead them to Christ.
I was pregnant in 2007.
And early on, she started spotting some blood. So we went, we were like, oh, what's going on? And they were like, oh, the amniotic sac broke in one. So we had lost one of the kids. And they were like, don't panic. Everything's gonna be okay. The other one's still stable and everything's okay. So we're like, oh my gosh. So we went from having twins to having one. And for the longest that I struggled with this because I blamed the doctors for not putting her on bed rest or something after that. They're like, no, everything's fine. Just continue your normal lifestyle. Everything will be okay.
I was 5.5 months and I noticed the umbilical cord, which is kind of crazy, but it was true. And when I went in that day, they just started pushing all the red buttons on the wall that I didn't even know were there. They were panic or emergency buttons, and I just had a baby right there in the doctor's office, really. And it was a boy, and he had been dying to have a boy since we have all these girls. But he wasn't there because I didn't even know what was happening or what was going on.
I was on my way there.
It just happened so quickly. And they had to admit me because I had to go through another surgery because of that. And it was hard. He got to stay in the room with us. When we did get back home, he cried so much and so loud, and I did too. And I remember laying on the ground thinking, I had kids, and I know the love that we have for our kids. But I laid on the ground, and you were in here, and I was on the floor, and I was crying and crying, and I just thought to myself, and it had been days, because we just laid around and we cried a lot. He cried a lot. We wanted a child together. But as I was laying there on the ground, I thought to myself, either I make the choice to keep being this way, keep laying on the ground crying, and let my kids get to see me like that a lot, or just get up and know that I have to keep going. I have kids at my house, I have a husband, I'm a wife, I'm a mom, I have to keep going. So really and truly, I laid there thinking, get up, and I had to tell myself, Candice, get up, just, you have to get it together. And I did. I got up and I just made the choice. I made my mind up that did happen. But and we talk about it in the house. But I had to keep going. I had to finish being a mom and a wife and just remember
that what we do have and what He has blessed us with.
And we haven't forgotten. By no means. It went week by week by week. I have something in my room, a lamb that the hospital gave me, and it's still sitting in my room. Mm-hmm. And I kiss it from time to time. You can see lipstick marks on it. My kids know they cannot touch it. It is mine. It just reminds me of that time, and it's right where I see it right when I get up in the mornings. But the girls, Farrah Macy has written 2 or 3 reports at school over the whole situation. And so it did hurt her. She was the oldest. But we just explained to her, you know, he's in heaven. There was a reason. We don't know it, but we will know it one day. Oh, you lead me with a strong hand.